Mr. President, Ministers, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this wonderful invitation. Let me start by telling you that I am a musician and an economist. As a musician, I am quite happy. As an economist, I am not. Mainly because of the way in which economics is being taught today in the universities and the way economics is being practiced in the world. We all know all the problems we are facing. So let me share with you why do I believe that we are in the world in which we are, because we could have been in a different way. Life is an unending sequence of bifurcations. The decision I take implies all the decisions I did not take. The route I choose is part of all the routes I did not choose. Our life is inevitably a permanent choice of one among an infinity of ontological possibilities. The fact that I was at a given place at a very precise moment in time, when a given situation occurred or a given person appeared, may have had a decisive effect on the rest of my life. A few minutes earlier or later, or a few meters away in any direction, might well have determined a different bifurcation and hence a completely different life. As the great Spanish philosopher José Ortega y Gasset pointed out, I am myself and my circumstance. What holds for individuals, for individual lives, holds for communities and whole societies as well. Our so-called Western civilization is the result of its own bifurcations. We are what we are, but we could also have been something we are not. Let us then revise some of our decisive bifurcations. Sometime during the 12th century in Italy, a young man named Giovanni Bernardone, while still very young and very rich, decided to radically change his life. As a result of his transformation, we remember him today under a different name, Francis of Assisi. Francis, when he referred to the world, spoke of brother sun and sister moon, of brother wolf and of water, fire and trees and people as brothers and sisters as well. The world he described and felt was a world where love was not only possible, but made sense and had a universal meaning. Sometime later, also in Italy, we hear the resounding voice of brilliant and astute Machiavelli warning us that it is much safer to be feared than to be loved. He also describes a world, but in addition, he creates a world. The world we have today is not that of Francis. It is the world of Machiavelli. Francis was the route not navigated. The navigation we chose was that of Machiavelli, and inspired by it, we have constructed our social, political, and economic conceptions. In 1487, another very young man, just 23 years of age, Francesco Pico della Mirandola, prepares himself for the public defense of his 900 theses about the concord between the different religions and philosophies. He refuses to enclose himself within the narrowness of just one doctrine, convinced that truths are multiple and never just one. He longs for a spiritual renovation that can reconcile humanity. Some years later, in this case, a fervent believer in absolute truth and in the possibilities of certainty, Francis Bacon invites us to torture nature so that through the delivery of her, so that through that torture she will deliver her secrets and we can extract the truth. Again, two words, one representing the route we navigated and the other the route we navigated not. We did not follow the way suggested by Pico della Mirandola. We opted for accepting Bacon's invitation, and thus we continue applying his recipe with efficiency and enthusiasm. We continue torturing nature in order to extract from her what we believe to be the truth, and if not the truth, at least the utility. In the year 1600, Giordano Bruno burns at the stake, victim of his pantheism, since he believed that the earth is life and has a soul. Everything for him are manifestations of life. Everything is life. Only 3 decades later, Descartes whispers in his Metaphysical Reflections, "Through my window, what I see are hats and coats covering automatic machines." We did not navigate the route of Giordano Bruno, we chose that of Descartes, and in that manner, we have witnessed the triumph of mechanism and reductionism. For Galileo and Newton, the language of nature is mathematics. Nothing is important in science that cannot be measured. We and nature, the observer and the observed, are separate entities. Science is the supreme manifestation of reason, and reason is the supreme attribute of the human being. Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, whose scientific contributions have been unjustly overshadowed because of his colossal achievements in literature and in the arts, Goethe felt upset with what he believed to be the limitations of Newtonian physics. For Goethe, I quote, "Science is as much an inner path of spiritual development as it is a discipline aimed at accumulating knowledge of the physical world. It involves not only a rigorous training of our faculties of observation and thinking, but also of other human faculties which can attune us to the spiritual dimensions that underlies and interpenetrates the physical. Faculties such as feeling, imagination, and intuition." Since, as Goethe conceived and practiced it, has as its highest goal the arousal of the feeling of wonder through contemplative looking, Anschauung, in which the scientist would come to see God in nature and nature in God. Two words, one more, another bifurcation. We are still under the spell of the overpowering luster of Galileo and Newton, and have chosen not to navigate the route of Goethean science. Feeling, intuition, consciousness, and spirituality are still banished from the realm of science, some new enlightenment arising from the field of quantum physics notwithstanding. The teaching of conventional economics, which, as incredible as it may sound, claims to be value-free, is a conspicuous case in point. A discipline where mathematics has become an end in itself instead of a tool, and where only that which can be measured is important. This has generated models and interpretations that are theoretically attractive, but totally divorced from reality. Johannes Brahms composed 2 concertos for piano and orchestra. Regardless of which of the 2 may be more to one's liking, the fascination is with the first. In fact, it is a splendid exposition of the route Brahms finally decided not to navigate. We have been left forever with the curiosity of knowing how the other Brahms might have been. That's the way it is. A route not navigated, remembered only by library wombs, and a navigated route to which we attribute spectacular successes and achievements. The university in particular has chosen the routes of Machiavelli, Bacon, Descartes, Galileo, and Newton.